You're listening to the Star Wars Actors Guild 77 podcast, the first in Star Wars social media entertainment and performance. We'd like to thank you for joining us. The Swag 77 team encourages you to like us on Facebook, follow us on WordPress, follow us on Twitter, circle us on Google, follow us on Tumblr, subscribe to us on iTunes, and like our character pages on Facebook, Twitter, and Tumblr. Your hosts are Josh or J.D. Mall of J.D. Mall Productions, Gina Moore Sanders, owner of Star Wars Actors Guild 77. Our co-hosts are the awesome supporters of Swag 77, who are social media entertainment professionals. Thanks for listening.
Okay, welcome, welcome. We are at the Star Wars Actors Guild 77 podcast. We are excited that you all are here. We've got a really great show planned for you. The Star Wars Actors Guild is your best social media entertainment and performance. We're a business fan organization where we tell stories, Star Wars stories, on Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, and Google+. We portray Star Wars characters on social media for fandom through reading, creative writing, and role play performance. And I'd like to welcome my co-host, Tony of Geek
Yo,
Talk.
Yo, yo, yo.
Yeah, woohoo! And our other co-hosts, you know, they are in school and work, and they were unable to be here, so we miss them, we love them. But they may show up later, so if they do, we're here. And the second thing I want to say is we have the most awesomest guest in the whole world for us right now, and that's the author of the new book, Star Wars, A New Dawn, John Jackson Miller. Yay!
How's it going?
Yeah. And I'm Gina, so if people don't know, we have some new people, so, but some people know me, it's kind of crazy. So, what we... Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So, you know, Star Wars Actors Guild podcast started with a strong review of the literature. When I say strong, we go in depth. And that's kind of what we're about. Because we want to be accurate, strong, and authentic when we portray our characters. So, for this podcast, there may be a few spoilers, but you can enjoy our level of interpretation and come to your own conclusions, or you could say something else. Oh, we have another co-host. We have Chris, our producer of Channel 1138.
Yes, I'm always here, but you'll hear my voice because I couldn't pass up the opportunity to talk to John here, so I'm excited about this.
Okay, yeah. And then, so to give you a little bit of background of A New Dawn that is written, it, for those of you that haven't had the chance to get the book, there have been delays. Some people have talked about that there are delays in getting the book. Don't know what's going on with that. But it's written by John Jackson Miller, yay! And it was released September 2nd. 2014, this year, and it serves, correct me if I'm wrong, but it serves as a prequel for the television series Star Wars Rebels that we're all geeked out about, right?
I believe that's what it is.
Yeah, it is, although of course it's also a bit more than that. It is the first, the first story in, sort of this new, Lucasfilm story group era of doing things. And it does have, the first meeting of the two stars of Star Wars Rebels. But I think, in a larger sense, it's our introduction to a time period that was always off limits before, this period in between Episode 3 and Episode 4. And so we get to see with this book how the Empire is really sort of getting started, ramping up, transforming, parts of the Republic into parts of the Empire. And you know, getting that huge Imperial fleet built. This is one of those things. It's sort of like the Swiss Army knife of books. It serves many different purposes.
Yeah, that sounds awesome. So what we're gonna do is, I'm gonna tell you. I have to be honest with you. One, I am so honored that you stopped by and talked to us. This is an honor for all of us here. And yeah. Then two, the Star Wars Actors Guild is about education, because I come from that background. And I really strongly believe in education, which includes reading and creative writing. And I went to your website, and it says, "What happens if your mother never throws away your comic books?"
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
And then you can spend your career strip mining your childhood. That's your right. Tagline?
that is, and it has been for a long time. Other people's mothers threw their comics away, back in the old days. My mother was a grade school librarian, so she made me put my comics in order. So
and you had to keep them neat too, huh?
Well, yeah, and I still have all the comics that I started with, plus about 50,000 more. So
that's excellent.
It became a career.
Yeah,
for me, I never actually got comics when I was a kid. So,
if I did,
it was maybe once in a great while because of the fact that my family I had four other siblings. So,
yeah,
well, it aggravated me that neither of my parents got comics as kids, because if they had and if they had kept them, they would have been worth a lot of money.
Funny though. That's real.
Oh, I know.
Yeah. I can vouch for that, because I follow some of the comics, and Superman itself, the first one on Action Comics, went for $3 million.
That's right.
Wow. Batman went up there too. That's what I...
Yeah.
The original.
If I could go back in time and buy some different comics than the ones that I bought, that would have been really helpful. But
you know, if you knew about them, yeah. So I also read that you have a bachelor's of journalism from University of Tennessee and a master's in comparative politics.
That's right. That's another way of saying Soviet studies. That was 1992 that I got that. And I actually was headed towards getting a doctorate in that. And
wow.
What happened was, in 1991, I was on the way home from Russian immersion camp, where there was a University of Indiana has a language camp in the summers. Where they teach you a language as quickly as they possibly can, so that you can go over to other countries and do research. And I had been in this Russian immersion camp for the summer, was getting ready to go back to LSU and start working on my application to go across to Moscow and do my my research. And I was hearing on the radio that there had been a coup d'etat in Russia.
Yeah, I remember that.
I jokingly say this, that the Soviet Union collapsed on my dissertation, but it is really true. The time I got to my, to see my advisor, my major professor at, once college started again after the summer, everything that I was planning on studying was gone.
No.
All the institutions that I was supposed to be researching. And the professor said, "Oh, well, you can just keep on going, and it'll just be of historical interest." And I'm like, "Yeah, I'm not a historian here. I'm hoping to actually be useful in terms of giving people some advice about what's going to happen here in the near future." Not the historians aren't useful, but things were happening so fast for that country at that point, that it wasn't the realm of historians at the moment. It was the realm of journalists who were actually there, doing the work of telling people what was going on. And that wasn't, what I saw myself doing. I also probably would have starved, because I'm a fairly picky eater. and I did not learn nearly enough Russian to, ask where the nearest McDonald's was. So,
oh.
So anyway, yeah, it was, I ended up going and, you know, just taking the master's degree and going back into journalism. And that led to a number of jobs that led to me getting into, you know, comics, you know, magazine editing, editing magazines about comics. And then that led to me getting to write comics, and that led me to me getting to write Star Wars comics. And, you know, that the rest is history.
Wow.
That's awesome. And it always fascinates me, stories about like how writers' lives end up impacting their characters and the stories that they write. So, John, like, do you think that those Soviet studies kind of influenced you later on when you were writing about the evil empire and Star Wars? Did you equate that?
You bet. I mean, you know, I'd had a couple of places where I'd used this sort of thing before. Yeah, the first comic book series I did was Crimson Dynamo for Marvel, which was, you know, the Russian version of Iron Man. You know, and then I got to use some of these ideas when I was writing Knight Errant, the comics and the novel a few years ago. But really, you know, I probably, you know, certainly with A New Dawn can attest that, you know, the Soviet early era, you know, the 1930s, when the Soviet Union is quickly transforming from an agrarian culture to an industrial culture, you know, to this military powerhouse, and, you know, it's only at the cost of, you know, millions of lives. You know, people that are being killed in the purges and you know, being forced to move to the collective farms, and some, you know, entire communities are just, you know, dispersed completely. You know, it struck me that a lot of what I was studying then would be of use when we're talking about the empire, because in this very early period, you know, we would be seeing the empire that is still somewhat recognizable as the Republic. It would not be as we saw it in episode four, where, you know, it's clearly a police state. And, you know, it's only places like Tatooine that are so far out that they're not under the heel of the empire. What I wanted to show was, you know, some actual oppression taking place, and it coming as a surprise to a number of people, because, you know, it struck me that it would have been something that would have, you know, sort of snuck up on people. The emperor was that, you know, crafty. He was drawing people into doing his dirty work for him. And then suddenly they would realize, as a couple of characters in our book do, that, oh gosh, this is a bad place.
Yeah. Yeah. So I have a small question. You can be very brief about it. And
I'm not sure I can be brief about anything, but I'll try.
You can if you want, if you don't have to. It's just, with this story, A New Dawn, like you've even said, you've taken some of what you've studied. Did you just come in with an outline ready, or the story group came with an outline and this is what you write?
Yeah, I was hired to write a Rebels, you know, prequel that would elaborate on some portion of the history of the characters, but, you know, also stand alone as a story on its own. I submitted several different, you know, proposals, connected to, you know, what the you know, the time frame where they said it was okay to work in, and some things that I would be okay in showing. One of my options was that I could show Kanan and Hera's first meeting, and you know, that's what we ended up doing. But it worked around this you know, the storyline of a sort of not ready for prime time group of you know, revolutionaries that we see in this book. So, you know, 95% of what we've got here, is, you know, my concept, my creation, but then we had the story group, my, you know, consultation with them made sure that what I did fit in with what they saw the galaxy as being like in this time frame. And certainly where they contributed a whole lot was, you know, as far as the characters of Kanan and Hera and, what they would be like at this point in time.
Yeah, so you did that, several drafts, and then voila, you have your book and you're ready to launch. Is that pretty much how it works?
Yeah, I wish it was exactly that quick, but yes.
probably a little more complicated than that, right?
Yeah,
it was. And of course, you know, I didn't find out about the introductory role that this book would have, you know, with regard to, you know, continuity and that sort of thing until I was well into the book.
Wow.
And the good news is that the way that I write, I always try to write, you know, these books such that somebody who's never read any other Star Wars novels can understand what's going on. So I didn't have to do a lot of backtracking or changing. You know, I don't do a whole lot of, you know, gratuitous callbacks to, you know, other things. And so, you know, and that's something that's changed over the years. I think in the beginning I used to do a whole lot of them. And as time has gone on, I've come to realize that it's a big galaxy and, you know, it's not the case that everybody's related to everybody else or that everybody would know everybody else. And so when I do it, I try and do it sparingly and where it makes sense.
Okay.
Did any of the other books ever inspire you for anything of this book or, like, say, past history?
Well, yeah, we did draw a number of things from previous previous books, and that's the thing. The expanded universe material was not discarded; it's still out there to provide inspiration and ideas and facts. So, you know, for example, the names of chemical compounds that are named in this book.
Yeah, wow.
Appeared in several other places that have been out there before. I mean, you know, if you're going to refer to an explosive compound, there's just no reason to reinvent the wheel or name a new one. And you know, it just happened that I made sure that the way that these things functioned was the same way that they had always functioned. Mm-hmm. So you know, I probably would have gone with a different name if it had functioned differently. Certainly I did take a look back at, some other, resources, we mentioned various, Imperial starships and Imperial shuttles and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
I looked at what, was probably in service at what time. And, then there's a few callbacks that are. I write these things so that you don't actually have to have, read everything before to catch them. Various things like, we have a character, Baron Danth, who is he's one of the aristocrats who's in the service of the Emperor. He has a connection with, a company that was manufacturing those heat resistant droids that we saw on the volcano world Mustafar in episode 3 it's just a very tangential connection, but episode 3, that counts, it's there. The movies are the basic document. That was a piece of supporting material for that book or for that movie that I drew upon, and that's where I got the name.
You know, that's the thing is, I don't know how much you know about what it's like for some of us that role play on Facebook and tell our stories as fan fiction. It's like we don't get a choice. We have to know all of the details, or at least it's important to me. You know, we have to know as many details we can and then catch up to the current literature. We can't say, EU canon versus new canon versus legends. We can't even go that way.
I think it's actually a pretty good, a reference that you make there as far as, in a sense, the past EU material is like, is like the background of a role-playing game.
Yeah.
It's like the stuff that you get, in the campaign guides or something like that. And I even have, I've written those myself.
Yeah.
It's material there that you can draw upon to create your own stories. And I think that's kind of the role that the authors are in right now. By mentioning something that appeared in the past, it's not as though we're waving this magic cannon wand and, now everything that, this character or that character in this previous, work did is part of the new history, or part of the history rather. But I think the key here is that it hasn't gone away. It's still there to be used. And you never know. I mean, I don't know where they're going with the new movies or anything else like that any more than anybody else on the outside does. Who knows how much they'll draw from.
Yeah. So that is one of the, we're going to go right into the book now. And yes, you guys are going to be small, not huge ones, but small spoilers. And one of them, and we're going to try to talk about these characters a little bit more, such as Obi-Wan Kenobi, Kanan Jarrus, Skelly, Hera, Count Vidian, Rey Sloane, and Baron Leero Danth. And the reason why I brought it up, I'm so glad you did bring up Baron Leero Danth. It's like, well, if his name, the D of his name was an S, that would be more intriguing. But we'll leave that one alone. And we also have some main ideas. These are just my opinion of the main ideas. There's the past, you know, of the movies that we've seen, and the Clone Wars show. And then there are the grunt workers, and I guess you could call them partisans in a way. And then the term, forget the old way. We've been going all on that all the time.
Yeah, that's Count Vidian's catchphrase. Forget the old ways. Yeah, he's very much this sort of character who he was a sort of a corporate fix-it artist, one of these turnaround guys, and that was sort of his catchphrase. Like Donald Trump has, you're fired.
Yeah. And, I got it.
Yeah, not that there's that much of a similarity between them. Although I think Donald Trump has more hair than Count Vidian does.
Oh, see, that was what I was going to ask. And then we have That's the awesome. Empire that you brought up a little bit about, and backstabbing. I was like, wow, I would have never backstabbed somebody that way, but I don't backstab, so. That's beside the point. And then your locations that you chose were really great. It's space, you know, how space is. And then Cinda, which is the moon that goes around Gorse, which is the planet. And this new place, Kalkaran, which I couldn't figure out, is that a planet?
That is a planet. The depot is in orbit around it.
Okay.
I can't remember how much detail I got into the planet. I think it was a world that has acid oceans across the entire surface of it, which is why the depot is in space. Again, these were new locations simply because I was planning on using them to such a great degree. Gorse. At least half of the book takes place on Gorse. Another third of the book takes place on Cinda. And because I wanted to make sure that I had free rein across all of it, and again, that's another example. Places, locations from the past. We use the names of earlier locations that existed. And it struck me that the kind of planet I needed here, the kind of system I needed here, was going to be something we hadn't quite seen before. This it's almost a double planet system here with the main planet is tidally locked to its sun, so it's one face of it is always facing the sun, and everybody lives in permanent darkness. There's a nice easy allegory for the Empire right there.
Yeah, wow, that is true. I didn't even get that one. Because I've been like, okay, I read your book, Kenobi, and without trying to do any spoilers here, you bring us to Master Jedi, Obi-Wan Kenobi, who has just witnessed the horrific horrors of Order 66, and then his battle with Anakin, now Darth Vader, and the loss of him, And now Obi-Wan has to rebuild his life. And then at the end of your book, almost at the end, we see the real, what it looks like to be a knight. When he battles him. That's what I read. And we didn't know that you would be writing A New Dawn. And then when you wrote A New Dawn, you say, like, after the prologue, avoid detection.
That's right.
What changed?
but again, that's that message that Obi-Wan sends in episode 3. He sends that message out to everybody saying, hey Jedi, something bad has happened. Do not come back to Coruscant. Do everything in your power to hide who you are. Of course he's hiding who he is most of the time in Kenobi. It's only in bad moments that he stands revealed as who he is. I wanted to show with A New Dawn sort of the flip side of Kenobi's situation, because Kenobi had a mission. He had a plan. He knew what had happened to the Empire, or what had happened to the Republic. He knew what had happened to the Jedi to a degree, and he had something to do with the rest of his life, which was watching over Luke Skywalker. Kanan Jarrus didn't have any of that.
Yeah.
He was cut loose. He was out on his own. He had no idea what was happening.
Like an orphan, basically.
That's exactly right. And of course, these kids didn't know who their parents were to begin with in the whole Jedi Order. So, it's one of those things where I wanted to show, all right, here's how this guy would probably be acting once you get about 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years in, and he realizes, oh, wait, nobody is coming after me. Nobody has found me. I've slipped through the cracks. The last thing that he wants to do is go out and become a rebel. And he's definitely reluctant, as we see him here.
Yeah, so someone in our group asked, we have a chat line going on at the same time. And I would like to present a question that they asked. And they said, what made you choose Master Depa Palaba as the master of Kanan, and how does she fit in the current canon, since she's not really in Attack of the Clones or Revenge of the Sith?
Well, that was something that came from Kanan's biography. That didn't come from me. Remember, by the time I came on board this project, Rebels was already well underway. They already had a story Bible and everything else. So, his history, was known. Hera's history was known as well, but I didn't get into Hera because we thought this is really Kanan's story that we're showing here. We wanted the reader to know about as much about Hera as Kanan knows about Hera. About as much as she shows him, of who she is and what her background is. In his case, that's not the sort of thing that I would have come up with, on my own. I try not to establish things, big important things, about characters when, that fact might be, something that, these people doing a TV show are definitely going to be able to spend more time with.
Okay. So, like I said, in Kenobi, we know that Obi-Wan Kenobi stays true to the Jedi code of forbidding attachments as he watches over Luke. That's as far as I'm going to go about that. Whereas Kanan is rather fresh with the ladies, like Lando Calrissian.
Yeah, but he doesn't.
Anything you want to tell us?
He doesn't stay attached very long. I mean, he's this man about town, and then he goes to the next planet. He's not traveling from planet to planet just because, the Empire is after him. They're not. He just gets bored. He he has no intention of being tied down.
Yeah, like the latest.
Well, he likes being a bachelor.
Yeah.
He's still pretty young as of this book, but he's had to be an adult for most of his life. So he really has sort of gone from planet to planet, and as soon as he goes to a world and realizes, oh well, this place is no fun at all, the Empire has made it no fun, he goes someplace else. He's not he's not a revolutionary in the sense that he wants to do anything about it. He knows that it's a big galaxy and the Empire isn't anywhere yet, or isn't everywhere yet. So he just keeps moving on. I really did look upon Kanan as somebody who would be in line with the character that we see in the animated series. Mm-hmm. Sort of this drifter, this cowboy type. Mm-hmm. And we wanted to show in this book how he decides to sign on with Hera and stay with her for a while. While still not yet being committed to being a rebel.
Wow. Okay, let's see if we have any more questions by our guests here. Let's ask this question from one of our co-hosts when he's not working is... without getting too spoilery, so to speak, did you come up with Kanan's real name, which is Caleb Doom, or was that something the story group gave you?
Again, something that was all part of what I got. I definitely try not to use more than I need to do in terms of establishing things. I didn't give Kanan an eye patch or anything like that. That they're gonna
darn it.
that they're gonna have to go put into the cartoon series. But really, I mean, here's the thing: one of the things that I learned at the very beginning, writing comics for Dark Horse, my editor there, Randy Stradley, he has a very good line on this. He says that when you define, you can find. When you add things into a storyline, particularly if you just add them for the heck of adding them, just for the idea of putting your thumbprint on Star Wars somewhere, putting your imprint there, you have a tendency to tie down other writers who have to do stories later on. Yeah. And the presumption here is, this is the first story in this new way of doing things. There's going to be a whole lot of stories coming along after this. So what you did not see was when I was writing up, Kanan's history, you did not see me being specific in terms of, time frame, in terms of, okay, well, he spent 3 months on this planet and then 3 months on this planet and then a month on this planet. And then there's no reason to do that. There's mm-hmm. absolutely no reason to do that. These characters, these heroes' lives, I know people like to put things into timelines, but these things need to be infinitely elastic. Because we're dealing with characters who, like Spider-Man has been between the ages of 18 and 25 for the last 50 years.
Yeah.
And he's never going to get any older than that. He's never going to be shown any younger than that. And it just doesn't make sense to say, he can't be fighting Dr. Octopus right now because,
he's not the right age.
We've already shown him at, doing something else at this point in time. I know that sort of coordination is fun and it can be useful, but the important thing is simply sequence. It's mm-hmm. not whether it fits on a calendar. It's sequence in terms of sequence of your reading, so you'll know what to read next. It's one of those things where you can go down the rabbit hole real quick in storylines that last a very long time by worrying too much about that kind of thing. I think back of the TV show MASH. How many Christmas episodes did they do? Versus how many years did the war last?
Yeah.
the war lasted, you know, 2-3 years, and they've got ultimately, I can't remember how many different Christmas episodes there are. But that's just the thing. I mean, I try not to add any facts that somebody else might be able to make a bigger story out of. And so a number of these things that look like big facts that I've added, are things that came in from outside or came in from the creators.
Wow. Okay, we're going to go to the bad guys now.
Sure.
So in a little bit of study, I found out that the name Vidian was a real life anatomy. I can't say that word. And for anatomy.
Antagonist?
No, anatomist.
Anatomist?
I don't know anatomist. If you knew that, but I found it. And after reading your book, I mean, I have to be honest, I still can't figure out what Vidian looks like.
Well, no, I describe it up front. He's one of those guys where he's got it's all there in the first chapter. He's got metallic limbs replacing the limbs that were destroyed by his disease that he had, he's got the same sort of the same sort of cybernetic implants in his eyes and ears and throat, made out of that's actually made out of a different material. But what he's got is for the benefit of other people who don't want to see the natural state of his face, he's got a flesh toned skin graft sort of mask artificial thing going there. I think of a number of characters like on the cyborg side, like Deathlok from the Marvel series.
Oh wow,
that's one character. And for the facial for the facial area. Let's go to a different movie. In fact, I don't know if everybody remembers seeing Darkman in the very beginning. That was that Liam Neeson movie years ago.
Yeah, I did.
He had lost his face, and so he had to actually use these flesh masks for his own face that were sort of dull and almost featureless. Vidian, and of course Vidian's got these glowing. High tech eyes and this booming voice. If you hear his, if you hear how Mark Thompson does him on the audiobook, I tweeted the other day that I just listened to that and it scared my cat off the couch. it's a very loud voice, but Vidian. The thought was we wanted to do something where he would be somebody who would be an important and powerful personality, but also he would have to have some physical power as well. And he's granted that by, the fact that he has remade his body in line with his philosophies. As a physical, opponent, he can actually put up a pretty good fight.
Yeah. Yeah.
So basically he's kind of the cybernetic Darth Bane type person.
No.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's...
He likes Darth Bane. You had to sneak that one in there.
Awesome. Reading Darth Bane, you have the image of a beefy man that basically get kind of, should I say, overpowering.
Yeah, so definitely. Well, one question I kind of had about...
some pretty horrible things in this book.
Yeah, definitely. One question I kind of had about Vidian was just, you mentioned one inspiration... for like the way his face looked, John, but like, are there any other historical figures or fictional characters that kind of have inspired his personality and that character, or is he more just like a general microcosm of what the Empire has become?
Well, take a look at the 1930s again, but now let's go to Germany, where you have a lot of industrialists who get in bed with the Nazis in terms of, trying to become a part of the Third Reich and trying to make sure that, they get to manufacture the airplanes for the Luftwaffe and that they get to do all these different things. That is something that I wanted to show here, which was that, Yeah, the Emperor couldn't just take over overnight. He had to have bought off all of these different politicians, all of these different aristocrats that ran the Republic over the course of, you know, all those years that he was chancellor. He would have, and even before that. So Vidian, as we find out here, he was somebody who was a contributor and a supporter of Palpatine, you know, well before the declaration of the Empire.
Yeah.
And he's somebody who is completely and totally on board with this new order, this new way of doing things. And, you know, it's, you know, obviously I've had to go to a different totalitarian state to describe this. But, you know, that's the trick with Star Wars and the Empire in general. You know, it is not a perfect, it is not a perfect analog for the Soviets, nor a perfect analog for the Nazis or for any, particular one historical group. It has to put together parts of, different totalitarian states that you've seen in the past and some things that we haven't seen before. It just struck me that, you know, this is, the Empire is still a place where money matters. It is still a place where, royal titles matter, Princess Leia. It is still a place where, these aristocrats hold some sway and need to be, brought on board, need to be co-opted. And that's where Vidian comes in. And of course, he thinks he's smarter than anybody, except for maybe the Emperor. And so he thinks that he's going to go far.
And that brings me to the next question is, you know, it seems like you got him, you tried to show in your book that Vidian said many times that he doesn't feel anything. He's devoid of that emotion, except for one, which is envy and jealousy.
And of course, that's one of the ones that the Emperor plays upon. You figure that the Emperor is like this professional golfer who's got a golf bag that's full of all of the deadly sins. he's with some people, he's going to use, greed. With some people, he's going to use envy. With some people, he's going to use, whatever he can find to get people to, lust for power or whatever. He's going to use whatever tool he can find to get people to sign on board. This is the thing, and we kind of show this with the Imperial Navy too, and with Rae Sloane. Nobody involved in the Empire believes that they're evil at this point. They all just figure, we're just trying to advance in this new society. It is, there's a dog-eat-dog nature to how things are now, but certainly there were a lot of things that were wrong with the way that the Republic did things. There has to be this period here where a lot of people still have bought in and are thinking, okay, this is still a good thing that we're doing.
And, okay.
So basically trying to make it day by day and nobody's all aware here.
Well, I mean, that's always the question when we look at these totalitarian states that take over. We ask ourselves, well, how did all these other people let this happen? Well, some people were, co-opted, brought into, what was going on, and other people just either, just didn't know enough about what else was going on, to be able to react or respond. And that's what's happening with Hera here. She's looking to see, what do the people know about what's happening? What is happening, and what do the people know about what's happening? How can we actually start a rebellion when these people don't even know any of the bad things that are happening? And this gets into, other things like the control of the media that we see in this book.
I love that.
Surveillance state that's in here.
Mm-hmm.
These are all things that, there's thought experiments is what they are. But you have to say to yourself, all right, how can a country like North Korea keep going for as many years as it has without having the people, rise up? Well, part of it is some of the people have been brought into the system and are profiting by it, and then the rest of the people simply don't know that things are any better anywhere else. They're being lied to, and they can't see what's happening elsewhere.
Yeah. Well, someone, I'd like to go to the chat, and someone brought up, speaking about bad guys, I guess those droids, those heat-resistant droids, were they part of the CIS, or do you have any more separatist references in any future works you might do?
Well, I can't speak to the future, but you know, certainly there is a plot point having to do with you know, Baron Dant and the and his company and the stuff that he's that he offers. One of the reasons that Baron Dant is trying to, you know, improve his position is, you know, all of these, you know, corporations that used to be part of the, you know, the separatists, you know, they're now part of the Empire as well.
Yeah.
They're all, and of course the Emperor can't just pretend that all of those, you know, all those separatists were, you know, that we're all friends again and it's all perfect.
No.
Certainly it struck me that he would at least have to maintain the illusion that these people are going to have to make their way back into the public good graces of the former Republic. And so, yeah, that's in there. Yeah, again, interesting things that are in here. I urge people to, you know, once they read the whole book,
yeah,
they can go back again and you know, kind of read between the lines on some of those things.
Yeah, explode. So, yeah, like, what's with all these explosions? I mean, are they, like, symbolizing a new era to come or what's to come, like, in the future, you know, that happens in A New Hope?
Well, right there we see in the opening crawl of the book, you know, there's a reference to all the unexploded bombs lying around. In the form of these people who are, you know, either, you know, the former Jedi like Kanan, or you know, Skelly, a Clone Wars veteran who, you know, was not a clone, but he is messed up, and he's somebody who, you know, has reason to question that very questionable war, among other things. You know, he's another one of these landmines that's out there.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the people who are sort of the, you know, the slower ticking time bombs out there. You know, Kanan, you know, being one of those, but also, you know, we have Zaluna, who is, you know, this character that's involved with a surveillance corporation that we see in this book. And, you know, what does she have? She has memories of how things used to be, and she has a perspective on how much things have changed. And, you know, in keeping with what I, you know, just said a little while ago there, that makes her a person who is a potential threat, because she cannot be snowed. She cannot be lied to by the Emperor about how things used to be. She used to see the Jedi in action.
Mm-hmm.
In her job, she knows that they weren't these bad people that they have now been made out to be.
Yeah, and that's what I really like about the little holodeck tickers, phrase lines that you put there. Those,
yeah,
well,
the headlines.
Headlines, yes. Those, I love those. I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna use those. So I had a few questions about the Empire, but I think you answered most of them. I was going to talk a little bit about Ray Sloan, because I listened to another podcast that did a little discussion about her, and I was like, okay, well, what is she really imagined to be as a character? She's just been, like, quote-unquote, the good girl that went to school, did all the work, got all A's, you know, passed the test, and is just humming along. Or is she a little bit, toward the end, that changes, but... you know, she's a little bit, you know,
well,
devious.
I think the question is, how does she see herself?
Yeah.
Ray Sloan sees herself as, we refer to them as the new Imperials, you know, which is not quite the same as something like the Hitler Youth or something like that. But it is, we can imagine this being sort of a phrase that people would use for this cadre of people, like the baby boomers or whatever, the people who came of age after the dawn of the Empire.
Yeah.
And so, you know, she would have been somebody who would have been in one of the earliest graduating classes from, what had been the Republic Naval Academy, now the Imperial Naval Academy, who, you know, most of her training would have been in the Imperial era. And so she would be somebody who would see a lot of the people as part of, you know, the past, a lot of the older captains and admirals and bureaucrats as people standing in the way of progress, people standing in the way of this really important and cool mission that is out there, which is, you know, what, the Republic has been sort of, you know, in this morass of politics for all these years. It hasn't been expanding like it could. It actually was managing to keep a lot of planets on the outside that it should have, and it should have brought in. Here comes the Emperor, who wants to consolidate power and security and build the largest, you know, fleet that any space power has ever seen, to go out and take over this galaxy and who knows what else. Yeah. And so she sees it as a quest, as an important mission, as a fun mission. But yes, as you say, she also sees in here that, you know, the way to get ahead in this empire is to watch your back, mm-hmm. and to take opportunities where they happen to be. And, in the beginning, she's thinking, well, you know, this Vidian guy is somebody who is totally in line with the new way of thinking. But maybe he's not the horse to black. Maybe he's not the horse to back in the big race. We don't know. She's always calculating. Everybody's always calculating. Doesn't make her a bad person. Necessarily, we see Vidian doing some horrible things. But I mean, at least she has more of an arm's length relationship to some of the bad things that we see in this book. But I wanted to, and really of all the books that I've done that probably prepared me the most for this in Star Wars, it would have been Lost Tribe of the Sith, where I was grappling with the issue of how a Sith government would be run when it is all about, you know, the glorification of the single person at the top. How would you organize this thing so that, you know, it wouldn't be unstable, wouldn't tear itself apart. And with Lost Tribe of the Sith, I got to show sort of three or four different versions of a Sith state, that rose and fell under their own weight because they didn't have the secret code that the Emperor came up with, that Palpatine came up with, of going out and finding an existing galactic government and taking it over from the inside, and then just working all the angles 24/7 to make sure that every waking moment of everybody is spent trying to advance the Empire, and maybe to advance themselves, but they can only go so far.
Wow. Yeah, and that brings us to my one of my last questions is, so on your book here, on A New Dawn, what does this say about the Force? Where's the Force going at this? Or is that left up to us, to the reader?
Well, Kanan is our Force-sensitive character here, and Kanan has basically tried to leave it behind. He sees that the people that raised him were devoted to this particular force, this particular religion, if you want to use Tarkin's phrase. Mm-hmm. In his eyes, it failed them. Mm-hmm. The people that were the most devoted to the force were all surprised. We're all unable to call upon it in their hour of need, And the Force, as far as Kanan is concerned, is not necessarily a trustworthy ally. And that is kind of how he is looking at it throughout this book. The problem is a Jedi's relationship with the Force is not something that he can crumple up and leave in a garbage can. Yeah. Like Spider-Man throws away his costume. It is not something that he can get rid of so easily. And it's always back there. And I tried to show that he was struggling with that. The fact that the Force was always back there, sort of biding its time, like Obi-Wan Kenobi, waiting to be useful somewhere, waiting to restore some of the balance to the Force, as it were.
Okay. So we have a question from one of our chat. They want you to answer again. When you write your books, do you ever go back and watch the 6 films and the Clone Wars while you're writing your novel?
Oh yeah, I quite a bit. Episode 3, I went and rewatched second for second, several times the sequence where Obi-Wan is sending his message out to people, and of course that's a moment that is. Referred to in the book. I wanted to see exactly what he did, and whether it was possible that he could have sent some of the other messages that we see here, like the message that's in this book. I wanted to see specifically what that room looked like, and so I described the room and where it is, and then I went back and I checked out some of the the old Dorling Kindersley, the DK Press blueprint books that show exactly where where these rooms are in relation to each other. And so I refer to the control room that's on the outside of it and everything. It is the case that I do check the movies, and again, the movies are the main basic document that we're working from. I did end up having a slight hiccup that wound up staying, in that there's a line on the back of the book, and it was originally going to be I originally intended it to be the first line in the book, the same way that Yoda has that first line in Kenobi on that first opening page about, until the time is right, hide we will. There is this line that the Emperor says in Episode 3. I don't have the book in front of me, but it's that the Jedi Rebellion has been put down. The Separatists have been defeated. We stand on the verge of a new beginning. And I wanted to use that line because it really connected with the title, A New Dawn. And also, it's a lie, so it sets up everything else that's in the book. But then I found out later that that line actually it's in the movie script. It was in the resource that I was reading it from, which was the comic book adaptation that Dark Horse did. But only about half of that line is in the movie. So, I checked to find out whether it was legitimately there to go ahead with, and yes, it is. So now that line is now read into the record.
All right, yay, you got that one. All right, Mr. Tony, you had a few questions, right?
Yeah. What was the most your favorite part of your most inspirational chapter of this book that you wrote?
Oh gosh, there's a lot of fun ones. I really enjoyed writing, Skelly at home, because this is our character who's the conspiracy theorist, and he's just got all sorts of other problems, and we get to see this really sad place where he's living, and it becomes, I think, easy, I hope, to visualize what this guy's life has been like. Just not good at all.
And, no.
He is such a fun character, and he's this combination of cynicism and yet wistful hope that somebody will listen to him, and hero worship for Count Vidian, and all sorts of other misplaced things. So these are the moments that I kind of have the most fun with. And of course, Skelly, as the book goes on, he just gets more and more fun to write, because somebody put it, I think, online here recently, he's not just comic relief. He actually does things.
He does
a lot. but I mean, I wanted to do a character that would be memorable and that when you would see him pop up on the page again, you'd be happy.
Yeah. He figured it out, though.
So basically, that's
right.
Probably safe to say that Skelly would probably be your favorite backstory of the whole book.
Skelly is actually the first character I created in the story. He was in all the drafts from the very beginning. He was somewhat different. May have even had different names in some of the earlier versions of the proposal. But I always wanted to do Mel Gibson conspiracy theory kind of character where the people that are your earliest rebels, your earliest revolutionaries, are never usually the people that are going to be really effective, going to be the leaders. Hera is an exception, but she's even convinced that anybody she's going to find right now is going to be either somebody who is got a grievance against the Empire, and because of that particular grievance, they're not going to be very big picture about things, or they're going to be nuts. And Skelly is, Skelly is hanging on by his fingernails. He's not, he's not nuts, but he's a really troubled guy. And I think that, the book does take him some interesting places.
Yeah. I do
Go ahead, Jaina.
Eventually, how Hera became incorporated. One of my favorite characters was Zelluna. I liked her.
Yeah, that's the head of the surveillance group. And again, this was going to be somebody who was going to be very reluctant. I tried to put myself in the position of somebody really working in that job. It's actually a big deal to go shoot somebody with a blaster, and a stormtrooper, even more of a big deal.
Yeah.
It is not something where you're going to just, wind up there, overnight or, after you've, had a conversation with somebody. There had to be, people in this who are going to be reluctant warriors at best.
Yeah.
Do you plan on doing some sequels to this book then?
Well, that's in the hands of that's in the hands of the publisher and Lucasfilm, and we'll see what comes. But certainly, we have characters, and we won't say which ones that survive this book.
Other than the ones we know.
Oh, no, it's a darn shame that Kanan and Hera were killed in my book. They're going to have to cancel this television series, and if only they had known before I wrote that chapter. Dog on it. At least it's possible that these characters might show up again. It's the same as, with some of the other characters that I've created and other stories that I've worked on. I'm full of stories, and I'm always interested in returning to it at some point.
Wow. So, Mr. Chris, you have one?
I just wanted to make a general comment. I asked the specific questions I wanted earlier, but I think it's just really awesome that you got the opportunity, John, to write a prequel to an entire TV show, and I think you did a fantastic job of it. I mean, with the Clone Wars TV show, we already knew most of the characters because it was characters from the films, but with Rebels, it's completely new characters, and it would be kind of difficult to go in and you'd have to kind of form your own assumptions about their backstories until they're actually told to you.
Yeah.
And so it's great going in actually having some backstories for some of the characters, because I think it gives those characters a lot more weight, and you already you're already empathizing with them going into episode one. And so I think that's great that you did that.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and yeah, certainly it helped again that I had the story group there to back me up on everything and teach me about these characters and the time. But I think originally the thought had been that this book might only just barely get out in time before the first episode of Rebels came out. I was very concerned that we wouldn't make it. And so I was never really sure that this would really be the first book, because I thought that, it might well come out afterward. And as it turns out, we wound up being, 4 or 5 weeks before the debut of the series. And, I guess that's kind of okay, because it does give people time to, as you say, read up on this and get a feel for the galaxy, several years before Rebels, but who these characters are. And again, for me specifically, it was a different kind of book than I've done before. I think the trick with, doing these tie-ins is you want to be challenged with something that is not quite, just like the last project or something that you've already done. And, with this one, I've never done something where it was a prequel set several years before something nobody has seen yet. I did it the other way with Knights of the Old Republic, the comics, several years before the video game that everybody had already seen. So all the surprises were already gone. this was a different way of coming at this.
Yeah. And what I got out of the book is, you brought a whole the newness of, this is a different era. It's not clear, which way it's really going to go. But you just started it off for us, and then it'd be interesting to see what happens.
I hope that this really is a starting point for people. It is designed to be a book that you don't have to have known about anything other than what's in the movies to be able to go forward with. And my hope really is, for all the books that are following Tarkin, Lord of the Sith, Heir to the Jedi, that I've kind of broken trumps here, and people will understand, okay, here's going to be, the way that these books are going to be done going forward. This is what story group books look like. It's not the case that we're running around here with a complete blinders on as far as what's gone on in the past. This book, I think, some people have said it comfortably coexists with everything that's already been out there. When I hear people say that this book could have been published 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, that makes me feel good, because I'm just trying to write a good Star Wars novel the same way that everybody else back then was trying to write a good Star Wars novel.
Yeah. So we have a question from our chat. We have a few questions. Someone asked, the Star Wars guru asked, is there any Star Wars character from your previous Star Wars stories that, I can't see it now, previous Star Wars stories that you would love to bring into this canon, the new canon now?
I'm sure there's a bunch. and of course, there's no reason to expect that they didn't exist until you see a book saying that they don't. Yeah, I mean, you're welcome to think that they did. It's obviously what's on the films and these books going forward is the official record. But I until somebody writes a story saying, okay, no, there never was a fugitive Padawan Zane Carrick years and years ago. There never was a con artist named Griff years and years ago. And I don't see how you would do that, and I don't see any reason why anybody would do something quite like that. Those stories will all still be out there regardless. As I've said you know, several times by now on the topic of these stories. The stories, if they speak to you, they speak to you regardless of how they interconnect with other books.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, one of the characters I do like to play, I've actually got on my Star Wars miniatures, is that I like to play with is Zane Carrick. So.
Oh yeah. Yeah, and you know, there is a little bit of a nod to the Knights of the Old Republic series. That there's a reference at some point where Kanan suggests that they send out for flat cakes. Flat cakes being one of the main dishes at the bistro that Griff and Slisk run from Knights of the Old Republic. So.
Wow. Yeah, someone asks how much control over the story did Lucasfilm Story Group have?
It wasn't over... really a big change. They provided feedback to the plot line. We had a discussion, with Dave Filoni and everybody else in the story group. We had a conference call about what should be in the book and what the approach should be. People then looked at the final product, the plot, the manuscript. Just made sure that the dialogue was in keeping with these characters, and then we did a few little tweaks, just to some of the terminology since there was this opportunity to make things a little more user friendly or reader friendly, there were some things that went away, like the refreshers. The refreshers are gone. we've replaced them with restrooms because there was no in-universe reason why they should have a different name.
Really? Wow. Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the thing is, there is this phenomenon in science fiction going back to the pulp days of the 40s and the 50s, where the science fiction writers would enhance how otherworldly their realm was by coming up with crazy high-tech names for what are clearly just household things. It's not a pencil. Give me the give me the wood draw-a-tron or something like that. And
God, all the EUites are just losing their mind. There are no more refreshers.
Well, but that, this is not news. This has been around in the online. We did a few interviews where this came up. The thing is, in this day and age, and particularly when we're talking about Star Wars, where it needs no help to seem otherworldly, it needs no help to convince us that it's a different place. You really don't need to have things that are almost self-conscious, these things that are gratuitous. We all remember Battlestar Galactica, first version, where they had their own fake names for what were clearly hours, minutes, seconds, years. Yarens and microns and centons and all of that. And part of it was to make you feel like it was a different place. But doesn't the big spaceship tell you that it's a different place? I assume that the decision on refreshers, just changing back to restrooms, was simply one where, we are trying to make something that will both, appeal to the readers that we've already got and also will be user-friendly to the person showing up who says, refresher, what is that? There was never a refresher. There was never anything with that term in the movies. Mm-hmm. Turbo lift. The term turbo lift is never used in the movies. There are a number of things like that were simply tweaked in the style. That's all.
Yeah. And it depends on how nitty gritty you really want. And that's a good thing about having like a story group. To keep P's and Q's, because then once you go from like a book or a script and then you go to a TV show,
Yeah. Well, I mean, a lot of things stuck around. I mean, one of the things that we can see in this book is we use the phrase groundquake still, because earthquake doesn't work. There is a good in-universe reason to call it groundquake instead of earthquake.
Yeah.
Or if it's something that just has a completely different function, is not the absolute equivalent. That's the time when you go make up a word.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's is that a writing style? That's stylistic, right?
That's stylistic. And again, there are style sheets that we work with. So.
Oh, okay. Now you know there's Star Wars style sheets.
There always have been. There always have been.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Did you guys know that?
Well, I mean.
No, I didn't. I assume,
you know,
though.
There has to be something somewhere so you know how to spell lightsaber.
Yeah. Well, you know, who was it? The CIA published their grammar manual or something? They did!
I thought it was Webster's deal with the doing lightsaber.
Yeah, that might be in there. Yes.
I actually didn't know how to spell lightsaber correctly before I got into this.
Oh, really? Yeah, there's a style.
My computer
manual.
Still doesn't.
That's probably why some people just use it as pulse saber.
Yeah. Anyway, do you have any questions for us?
No, I just I really appreciate the support that everybody's shown this book, and I'm really just been touched by a lot of the great things that people have said online about this. I'm glad that people gave it a chance, I'm just looking forward to seeing people here as I do my little tours here. I'm going to be at New York Comic Con in October. I'm going to be doing a swing through the Southeast in November, Lexington, Kentucky, Knoxville, Tennessee, Charleston, South Carolina, Memphis, Tennessee. A lot of places that I haven't hit before to talk about this book and everything else that's coming out. And then, of course, my next book that I've got coming out is my first Star Trek novel, and that comes out in January. So it's probably illegal to talk about that on this podcast, but I hope people will like what I do there.
Yeah. Star Trek, how do you keep them all, keep the style manual?
Well, that's where styles come in real handy, because you can accidentally use one phrase or the other. Yeah, I really think that's kind of how Turbo Lift made it into Star Wars. It came from Star Trek, because it's not
set your blasters to stun.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's not blasters, it's phasers, and it's not phasers if the enemy has them. If the enemy has them, they're disruptors.
No.
So.
Keep track with that.
Yeah, no, it's all those these things that you figure out or find out about as you're working in a different playground. I've now done Marvel and Mass Effect and all these different worlds, and you sort of have to get used to what language you're going to be speaking when you get back into it.
Yeah, someone said, the Star Wars guru said, that your latest article in StarWars.com about Journey to Star Wars, A New Dawn, was amazing. Yay!
Yeah, thank you. That is that's the blog post I did the day the book came out, and that was something where I was talking about, it starts with me getting the first EU, book, the Splinter of the Mind's Eye, of the novels. And then I follow from there with photos of me as a kid, really embarrassing photos my sister was able to find from old Polaroids.
Ain't that the way it is with siblings?
Well, yeah, I actually sent her to go find them, so I appreciate that she was able to do that. But I was astonished that we had some of those still. including the roadside X-wing that blew my mind that we still had that was a frightening tourist attraction that we found there just on the back of a trailer of a car. I wanted to sort of show people that I'm in the same role as everybody else. I'm a reader of this stuff. I discovered Star Wars. I discovered Splinter of the Mind's Eye. I discovered the comics. I discovered Heir to the Empire. I discovered all of these things. And at some point here, I got the chance to write. But I am still writing to myself and the people that, you know, I know are out there who are readers like I was, trying to, tell, stories that keep Star Wars alive. And that's what that blog post really was about.
That's awesome. Well, we like to thank you for showing up on our show and talking to us a little bit about your wonderful, awesome book.
Thank you. And folks can find out more about it. Farawaypress.com is my website. I will have a behind-the-scenes page on there about the book sometime later this year. I don't know when I'll get it on there, but there's already one on there on Kenobi and every other book that I've ever done. Folks can also find me on Twitter at JJMFaraway.
Okay, we'll put that in there.
But definitely, thanks for having me on here. I do appreciate it.
Yeah. And we'll just go through what we do afterward, after we have wonderful guests. Yay, and then that's it. All right. If you ever want to reach us, we have everywhere. I just posted it in chat. Our main Facebook page is facebook.com/iGotSwag77. And if you want to go to our blog, it's swag77.com. We're also on iTunes, and if you'd like to leave a review, that would be great. And if you want to find us on Twitter, we're at swag_77, and info@swag77.com is our email. And this is why we read the books, because we don't get, this is why we love to include people, because to get this real look of what these characters are about. And sometimes we can have varying ideas, and we want to be on the same page, right? Right.
And that's, of course.
Of course. Stay tuned. We're mostly on Sundays at 7 p.m. We'll have more to talk about later, right?
Yeah, I'll be actually getting caught up with the book and with the Audible book here this next week or so before next show.
Okay. So. Chris, do you have anything?
Nope. Are we ready to play the outro?
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody, for listening.
Have a good night.
Good night.
Thank you for listening to the Swag 77 podcast. Once again, be sure to like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. We are all over social media. Also, if you would like to come on the show to talk Clone Wars, Star Wars books, Star Wars comics, etc., or you would like to be interviewed, email jdmullproductions@gmail.com. If you would like to leave a voicemail, record and email one audio file to us through Facebook or the previous email. And finally, remember that Swag 77 is an independent fan organization and is not endorsed by or affiliated with Lucasfilm or LucasArts, and is for entertainment purposes only. Lucasfilm, LucasArts, Star Wars, and related properties are trademarks in the United States and other countries wherever Lucasfilm Limited and its affiliates reside. Lucasfilm Entertainment Company has all rights reserved. May the Force be with you always.
Thanks for listening.
Thanks for listening, and as always, may the Force be with you.